everyone. Welcome back to Working People, a podcast about the lives, jobs, dreams, and struggles of the working class today. Brought to you in partnership with In These Times Magazine and the Real News Network, produced by Jules Taylor, and supported entirely by listeners like you. My name is Maximilian Alvarez, and I'm just popping in real quick to let y'all know that we're taking a much-needed break this week. You know, as you guys have probably noticed, hopefully noticed, we've been working our butts off this summer to, you know, cover lots of important stories and to bring you lots of great new episodes. Even to the point where we released 3 separate episodes in 1 week earlier this month. That was the week that we did 2 episodes on the coal miner strike in Alabama and 1 on the pharmaceutical plant closure in Morgantown, West Virginia. So, you know, when Jules told me that he was going to be in the remote Vermont wilderness without Wi-Fi for a week, I said, good, take a goddamn break. So we're both taking a much needed break. But Jules, especially with everything that he's been editing, definitely deserves to unplug for a bit. So, you know, we'll be back with more worker interviews very soon. But to hold you guys over until then, we decided to release a portion of the truly amazing group conversation that we had for our first ever Working People listener hang session last week. I cannot tell you guys how special this hang session was for me personally. You know, I started this show years ago with a dinky recorder that I borrowed from the library. So, you know, the reality that I would be on a Zoom call talking to listeners and friends of the show who were calling in from Calgary, Michigan, Georgia, Oregon. I mean, it was just surreal and humbling. And, you know, it reminded me of why I started the show in the first place. And honestly, what I always hoped it would become. And, you know, we also had some great guest appearances by beloved comrades and past collaborators on the show, like Jacob and David from the Valley Labor Report, Brian from Strike Wave, and more. So I think it's safe to say that our first listener hang session was a major success, and we are definitely going to be making these a regular thing. You know, from the bottom of my heart, I want to thank everyone who attended. I want to thank Jules for organizing and editing the whole thing. And I just wanted to thank all of you, you know, listening out there for tuning in every week and supporting this project. You know, we love you all. We'd be nothing without you. And, you know, if you couldn't make this last listener hang session, then be sure to call in for the one that we're going to put on next month in September. Now, if you want to watch the full video version of the listener hang session, and, you know, if you want to get a boatload of Working People bonus episodes to binge while we take this little break, then head on over to patreon.com/workingpeople. That's patreon.com/workingpeople, and become a paid subscriber for just $5 a month. We've got more bonus episodes coming your way, and we're going to be doing more interactive and video-based stuff moving forward for our subscribers, and you definitely don't want to miss out on that. And lastly, before I head out, since we are off this week and probably won't be able to cover it ourselves, I just wanted to send all our love and solidarity to striking Nabisco workers. In case you guys missed the news, hundreds of workers at Nabisco bakeries across the country, and yes, that is the company that makes Oreos and Chips Ahoy. So these workers are currently on strike. You know, just like with the Frito-Lay workers last month. And you guys remember that we talked to one of them, the great Sherry Renfro. If you haven't listened to that episode, you should definitely go back and check it out. But just like the workers at Frito-Lay, workers at Nabisco made sacrifices and worked their asses off during a pandemic to meet increased demands and make huge profits for Nabisco and its parent company. And now, how is Nabisco repaying them? It's repaying them by closing bakeries and trying to bully the union into taking more concessions. And we say, fuck that. So don't buy Nabisco products, show public support for the strike, and help hold the line until Nabisco starts treating its workers with the respect they deserve. All right. Well, on that note, I'm out. So thanks again to all of you for all your love and support. To tide y'all over until Jules gets back, here's a portion of the group conversation from our first Working People listener hang session. You know, I like on that note, I was curious to see if Brian or David, if you guys had like stories about how you provide that political education for folks as organizers.
Very carefully.
I mean, expand on that. I'm pulling my Larry David or Larry King. Expand on that.
I mean, like the tough part is, I find that when I've run organizer trainings, a lot of the rank and file activists for the union I work for, like officers, stewards, even folks who are just looking to organize, not necessarily looking to do representational work, there is a hunger for knowledge about this stuff. And it's important to me, like, I come to this from sort of, I kind of try to approach this from a storytelling perspective, right? Because I think narrative, when you're not talking like really kind of hardcore academic history, like narrative has a lot of power, and has the ability to capture the imagination in ways that other things kind of struggle to do. And so I always make sure there's a really strong labor history component that's, you know, rigorous. Like it's not, I don't invent shit out of whole cloth, but it's interactive and it's grounded in the actual history and the actual struggles. And the point I always try to make is that the fundamentals, like the reality has changed for working people in this country, but it wasn't inevitable for it to change. And it took people willing to take action, just like you, taking action in far more dangerous times with far greater risk, with far more ambiguous rewards, that in trying to drive home that they're the inheritors of that, right? Like one of my favorite like labor stories is the union organizing drive in Bogalusa, Louisiana, that took place just after the First World War. It is a remarkable story. It is a story of workers, black and white, coming together despite the limitations on what they were able to do, because they still organized and segregated locals. But at one point you had company thugs essentially threatening the black part of town and in trying to intimidate people out of like black folks from attending the upcoming union meeting. The white union's response to those threats was, they got 100 men together, including 12 folks, like all of them were World War I veterans and 12 of them were just demobilized in uniform. They put guns in each hand. They marched into the black part of town and they provided escorts to any Black person who wanted to attend the union meeting. Like, for me, like, that story, that is so powerful, because when you think about that story, like, what must have it felt like for the Black unionists? They spent their entire life. This is 1920. This is
when Ellie, let's go.
Jim Crow is at its zenith, like absolute power. And the thing that they probably, like, those Black workers lived in terror of more than anything else was white people coming into their neck of the woods with guns to kill them. And here, instead, you see white people coming into their neighborhoods to defend them. The story does not have a happy ending. The cop, the company and the police and the paramilitaries came together and ultimately put down the strike violently. Three white trade union leaders in Bogalusa gave their lives to let Soldakis, the Black union leader, escape from a lynch mob. And so, like, for me, those kinds of stories, I think, are really important because it does show just how fragile all of this that we have is. I'm talking about something that happened just 100 years ago. Like, the Blair Mountain Centennial is this month. Like, these things, like, we have made this world different, but but we will only preserve it if we can fight to keep it. And I think that's the important part about labor history, is to give that kind of grounding to people in ways that they otherwise wouldn't.
Fuck yeah, man. I mean, that's incredible. I mean, how do folks respond to that when they hear that history?
It's potent, yeah. Right? Like, this is something that, like, when you put that in front of them, like, it hits like a freight train. Because, and especially, like, I have to always point it out to the white unionists, like, what that is and the significance of it. But all of the Black folks that I work with and I train, every single one of them catches all the significance. And that is something that is real. I am dropping a link to the best article about the Bogalusa massacre. It's in the chat. It's like I said, it's not a happy end. But Stanley O'Rourke, J.P. Bouchillon, and Lem Williams, they gave their lives to save Soldakis from a lynch mob. And that's something that people don't remember because it's not something that happened. It happened when labor was at its nadir, right? Historically in the United States, where there were no effective laws, labor laws or anything like that. And basically they were hammered down. And if this had happened in the 30s, like, it would be celebrated and they might have won, you know, like, if this had happened in the 40s, it would be remembered. But it happened in 1919. And the only thing that came of it was misery and pain. And it was an honorable fight, but, like, it's something to hammer home too, that just because you're on the right side of things don't mean you're going to win. Like, the good lost here, not because they were wrong, the good lost here because they weren't strong enough. And that's another lesson that people need to take from this and take from labor history.
Fucking A. I mean, and this connects to, I think, directly to a point in the chat. Megan, do you want to, I guess, first say hi and then and throw this into the pot? Because I think it's deeply connected.
Yeah, I guess. I was just talking about, I read a book called History is Mystery by Michael Parenti, who's one of my favorite left-wing writers, but he essentially just talks about, if you really consider the way that history is written and orchestrated, even whenever you think back like long time ago, well, who are the people that are writing those? It's never working class people. It's always people that are sort of in the upper echelons, the ruling class of society. And so lots of times, kind of the more working class or everyman position is looked over and just lost to history in general.
And it's like, I mean, thinking of like that in conversation with the amazing story that Brian just told us, right? The thing that it makes me think, right, is, you know, I like everyone who listens to the show knows that I grew up very conservative, right? And one of the automatic kind of conservative responses to kind of progressive leaning politics in our day and age is, it was a different time back then, right? You know, people didn't have the kind of political values that we do now, which is like, you know, on the surface, understandable, but there's this kind of way that we pretend as if no one was fighting on the righteous causes, like, as opposed to thinking Brian was saying then, and Megan was saying, is that like, well, actually there were people fighting, but they lost, right? I mean, like, you know, or they lost that round in history. And it wasn't until later that we were able to recover that history. But, you know, this seems like just another way that sort of ruling class narrative perpetuates itself, is it erases the evidence from the past of those who stood on that side of the good and the just, whether it be during abolition, whether it be, you know, a century ago, you know, in terms of biracial, you know, racial solidarity in the labor movement. It's really sinister, right? Because like, it works, right? Like, I think we all attested here, most of us didn't know about any of this shit growing up.
This is one of my pet hatreds, is the phrase, oh, he was a product of his time. The fact of the matter is, you're right. Like, and it's always used in defense of the Confederacy and the slave state and all this other stuff. They were products of their time. You know, Stonewall Jackson, Robert E. Lee, they were products of their time. Jeb Stuart was a product of his time. You know who else was a product of his time?
Abraham Lincoln.
I was going to go with John Brown or Frederick Douglass or Harriet Tubman. All three of those people were products of their time. Auguste Village was a product of his time. George Henry Thomas was a product of his time. All of them made the decision to oppose slavery and fight against it. All of them made significant personal sacrifices to do so. Like, the fact of the matter is, at every single point where you see this kind of grotesque injustice, you always see people who are articulating criticisms of it. You know, you see violence and oppression occur during the English Civil Wars, but you also see like the diggers in basically creating sort of what you would describe as a sort of a proto-communism and of living together and working the land as a group, as a whole, rather than parceling it out, right? Like, it's entirely comfortable to basically say, and this is why the history matters, is to know when the people who were right and who they were, and when the people on our side who weren't right and who they were, and to know where they fell short, so that we don't romanticize them.
Well, that's why I threw in Abraham Lincoln, because he was clearly racist. He didn't believe black people were equal to white people. He was a product of his time, but obviously, you know, took up battle against slavery. Mm-hmm. But I certainly agree with that.
And also he ordered the largest mass lynching in Minnesota history of Capture Dakota people.
Well, like, you know, I think, like, you know, this is another, like, kind of thorny issue. I'd be curious to hear how folks have thought about this in your own lives, right? Because I think for me, you know, I asked this question on Twitter a couple weeks back, where I was asking folks, I was like, what are the arguments or points that you're, you know, more conservative leaning friends, family members, coworkers make that you find it difficult to respond to, right? You know, what are the arguments that we need to work on, right? And I think that a lot of folks pointed kind of to something that's related to this, because I know, at least in my former brain and in, you know, the ways that I was brought up, that kind of talk about, you know, people being product of their times and this kind of washing out of the people and groups and movements in history that were trying to push history in a different way, but weren't able to, is like, when you wash that away, I think the sinister sleight of hand is you try to basically sell to people this notion of like an unchangeable human nature, right? It's used as a justification for why things can't change, why they won't change, why, you know, we need to temper our expectations of how good society can be. And like, we're kind of seeing that unfold right now, right? It's like with COVID, with climate change, you're already seeing this kind of knee-jerk response to like, well, no one's going to live forever, right? Or, you know, we can't save everybody, right? And like, how do we fight that? How do we, like, not just rhetorically, but, you know, in general, how do we kind of fight off that sort of nihilism, even in our own, in the ways that we think? It's a loaded question, so please don't feel like you know, you have to tackle all of that, but I'm thinking out loud here.
I think that you have to teach people that the power comes from them and not from some policy. Like, it doesn't, like, when we talk about labor history in particular, like, what we're really saying is that before the AFL-CIO was a huge thing, you know, before unions were this established thing, there was this, you know, primordial soup that, like, the labor movement emerged out of. And it relied on people, like, figuring things out for themselves. Like, we talk a lot about things like mutual aid, you know, these days, and, like, how it helps build working class power. And, like, people didn't have to talk about it that way back then. It was just part of how they were going to get through the strike. It was just part of, like, how they were going to mobilize, because they saw the need. And I think that, like, the challenge, at least when I talk to my own family, in, like, trying to, I don't know if I can really assuage any of them of their conservative beliefs, but I guess when they come at me or the rest of my more left-leaning family members about, like, how people are inherently greedy or selfish, which I think is another big one, like the weird biological tone which they kind of, like, pursue that angle with, I think that, like, the opposing part is also true. Like, people, like, the working class has always bonded together, even when it wasn't backed up by law. And, like, that's really where the source of power is. And I think that that's the competing narrative that works, at least in organizing people. Because I think that as long as we fall back on, like, talking about labor leaders or, like, I don't know, the New Deal saving us or the Green New Deal saving us or things like that, then we kind of neglect the reality that it was just working class people in a desperate situation that turned to each other and said, we're just going to do this ourselves. And I think that's the cooperation, like, that's the antithesis to, like, the greed and everything else that the conservatives tout is, like, so innately biological to us.
You know, there was an episode that Max did with Nate Holdren, and Max, your last question kind of led off with, like, how do we argue back against this sort of, well, no one's going to live forever, or the sort of nihilism. And I think I think Nate brought up some points that, as far as the usefulness here, to combat that specifically, I think it comes down to, you know, it's like when they say no one's going to live forever, you have to say something like, okay, so tell me who's not going to live forever here. Like, show me, like, who is it specifically that is not going to live? You know, like, because so often when people say things like that, they're not imagining people who are irreplaceable to them. They're not imagining people that mean the world to them. They're imagining some other person. So when you read statistics from like that Nate found in his research of like something like on the order of, you know, the math comes out to like 5,000 members of the working class die on the job per day worldwide. And when we hear those numbers, we don't actually like we avoid somehow like the singularity of personhood. Like 5,000 people doesn't mean like 5,000 people that are unique individuals with personalities that are dear to other people, that are dear to their families, that, you know, dislike their older sister because they, you know, because she did this to them when they were younger. Like all these things that that constitute our personality, that make us into human beings, that, you know, it's hard to see the singularity of personhood through the large numbers and atrocities and things like that, right? So so I think it really comes down to like kind of like, you know, if you're going to deny me healthcare, do it to my face. Like, don't look me in the face and tell me that I can't have healthcare. You know, it's not waving that stuff away with a pen is one thing from on high, but like confronting that singularity, I think is part of the what needs to be done to argue against that sort of nihilism.
That point comes up a lot with health and safety, because when people are killed at work, it's buried in the back pages, if covered at all. I mean, if like the folks who died in the Challenger, when that exploded, if every workplace death were treated that way, it would be different, but it's not. That's one of the things that we are working on all the time to, you know, highlight those things. And, you know, from my background in public health, I mean, if you want to know who's going to die early, just look at the amount of economic resources they have. And that's an indication who's going to die at an earlier age, who gets more disease, who has more, you know, physical and psychological issues to deal with. It's money.
Mm-hmm.
And it clouds that those who have the resources don't think about that. It's easy for them to say, oh, well, you know, that person's going to die because they don't take good care of themselves. And why don't they take good care of what are they facing that you're not facing as someone with more economic resources in terms of, you know, access to food, access to healthcare, access to childcare, all the things that are missing when you have less money.
You know, is this like in a lot of ways, and I guess I would preface this by saying the subject that we're talking about here is obviously infinitely bigger than our little show here. Right. But I guess I would be lying if I didn't say that in a lot of ways, this is kind of like the core of, I think, what Jules and I try to wrestle with week in, week out. And even from the day that I started the show, what I was, even if I didn't know that this was the question I was asking, it was very much kind of the light that I was seeking. Because we're seeing it happen even now, right? It's like we see the ways that even well-meaning people kind of rationalize mass death and unnecessary mass death, whether we're talking about climate change, whether we're talking about COVID-19, whether we're talking about, you know, a fire at a factory in Bangladesh, right? I mean, like there's a sort of, I think, protective measure that our brains sort of have that washes out, right, the deep humanity that is being lost at every turn, because otherwise it would just be too overwhelming. I remember writing a piece for Current Affairs a little while back about a Guatemalan boy who died of the flu in the custody of Border Patrol here in the United States. And I just, like, you know, was crying, writing it, crying, thinking about it, thinking about just all the needless pain that he felt before he died, all the pain his family felt, knowing that he had died. And when the video kind of came out, having to see that and not be able to comfort him. And you know, it just even just that one instance was kind of overwhelming. And so I feel like, you know, one of the things that the society that we live in teaches us to do is shut it off, right? Don't think about that. That's what capitalism has to recommend it, is your ability to live with binoculars on, right? To only need to be concerned with your kind of immediate sphere, and be told that that's okay, right? And we're trained to do that from a very early age. From, I remember one of my most vivid memories when I was a kid in LA, walking around with my mom, you see homeless people, right? And you as a kid, you're thinking, why is this person on the street? Why aren't they in a bed like where I sleep, right? And you know, your parents don't have money to give to everyone, right? They are maybe concerned about you and whatnot. So you kind of are trained from the most early age to wipe them out, right? To kind of scrub, you know, that sort of like humanity out of the periphery of your vision and only focus on the steps ahead of you, right? And, you know, I think that one of the things that we try to do on the show, and I'd be curious to hear if folks think that we're doing a good job, or if there are things that we could be doing better, or ways that you've found that you've been able to kind of tackle this in your own relationships. But like trying to bridge, right, valuing and showing and lifting up the sacredness of every human life, right? You know, the beauty of every human life, the uniqueness, the singularity, as Jules was saying, of every human life, and knowing that that is, like, you know, what makes it so precious and so worth fighting for. We try to kind of hold that at the same moment that we try to connect that to a larger sense of collective mission, right? Like, how do you take that appreciation for the sacredness of every individual life and connect it to the necessity of larger collective working class solidarity and political action? Does that make sense? Am I going off the philosophical deep end here?
Yeah, no, I think it makes sense. I think, but it also, to me, is kind of the same question in a way, because a lot, like kind of Jules was saying, that when people say, oh, well, everyone's going to die or nothing's ever going to change, you know, a lot of people, because they feel that apathy, well, then the thing is that it's like, well, yeah, everyone's going to die. So when are you going to do something about it? Like, you have to kind of first instill, sort of like activate the fact that, you know, your time is limited, that what are you going to do with this life, or what are you going to do with the choice that you have, the opportunities that you have? You know, when are you going to start like an organizing effort or whatever? And then that can sort of make you start to see more of the humanity overall.
Fucking hey. Yeah. I mean, it's like, I think the other kind of thought that I had on that, right, was like, is this notion that, that everyone's going to die, right? This absolutist way of talking about things. Everyone's going to die at some time. You know, you can't save everybody, right? Yeah, you know, not everybody can be successful, right? It's just all these kind of rhetorical ways that we, you know, kind of justify the injustice all around us. But yeah, really, I think where the nihilism does come in, right, and where it stops us from taking that step that Megan was talking about, of like turning that into action, right, is this real, like, it goes back to that kind of history question. It's this real sense that like whatever we do won't matter, right? And that's a trained mentality, right? That's a mentality that we get when we are told that history itself is only made by great men, right? I mean, there's a goddamn show on the History Channel called Great Men of History. it drives me up the walls, because it's like Rockefeller, and it's like, look at all that Rockefeller built. And I'm like, Rockefeller didn't build shit. The workers built everything, right? He just had the fucking money. And I mean, like, but it again, it just convinces you that unless you get to that level of like being a Jeff Bezos or, you know, a I don't know, Joe fucking Biden, like that is the only echelon at which you can actually have any sort of imprint on history. And that's a real, violent thing, right? Because it's disconnecting us from the truth of our own history, right? Everything around us was made by working people. And yet the ruling class, going back to Megan's point, has convinced us that they made it and only they can make it.
Yeah. You know, I will say that to say that, oh, well, that's the way the world works, or that's the way things are and things are never going to change. I think all those statements like kind of presuppose that like the person making those statements is like separate and apart from like, that's how things are. It like presupposes this distance as opposed to the point of view that, that you're not distant from it, that you are of it and embedded within it and are shaped by it, you know, like this sort of perspective that you are an agent of change and everyone can wield a certain, like it's almost like to say that, well, that's the way things are is like a denial of human agency. It's a denial of like the implications of political struggle as well. So it fundamentally presupposes, I think, a certain distance, whereas, you know, it would be really funny if someone was like, you know, well, that's the way things work. And it's like, well, at this point, you and I, our disagreements are so far apart, I can't even begin to try to convince you that, you know, to have more imagination or to think that things are only the way they are because we only have like a historical memory of like so far back, and like even police are only like 200 years old, you know, but they have this way of appearing in society as already always having been there, as something that is taken for granted, when really it's like they're not more than a couple hundred years old. So I think it's a matter of like, how do you convince someone to consider that they are inside of the world and part of the world and shaped by the world and have agency within that world, as opposed to this sort of like reductionist outsider, no imagination perspective that it's apart from you and happens outside of you and has maybe no effect on you.
You know? Mm-hmm. Well, hey, go for it.
All right. And I think just piggybacking on both what Jules had to say and you, Max, is at least in my experience in hunger relief, that, and even I have to admit, like I have felt that creeping thinking, you know, I've felt that style of thinking creep into like even my mind sometimes as well, or you know, I know it's there, but we also sort of in my experience, that hypersimplification of, you know, like the fact that we'll never get rid of hunger or poverty or homelessness or things like that kind of just is used by folks as like the start and end of the argument, as sort of like this true like standalone statement that kind of gives them not even an out, because it's just like we're not having a debate or discussion at that point, but it's like you just want to say like, are we not even going to try to move the needle? So it's like, all right, if you don't want to have, if you're even admitting that like, oh, we'll never get rid of hunger or poverty, like, is this the best we can do? Or like, are we fine with having 42 million people in America be food insecure? Or having the worst part, having 35 million Americans be hungry, like pre-COVID, when like we were at pretty much full employment. And a lot of those working families being food insecure. So you have, you know, folks like the dipshit on Fox, the guy you shared, Max, who was like the guy with the bug eyes, the crazy eyes, who was talking about like, oh, you don't have, you know, they, you know, folks are hungry. That's how you'll get them to work, is, you know, hunger is the best motivator. And it's like, are you fucking kidding?
Literally compared workers to dogs, saying like, if you want an obedient dog, keep them hungry. He said that on Fox. I don't know if anyone saw that. This is like the bar rescue piece of shit.
Yeah. So it's like, I'm Googling on one hand, like how to punch someone through a computer screen. And on the other, I'm like trying to write down, like, you know, just trying to grapple with how do we even at a base level try to, you know, move the needle of not just the socioeconomic issue that, like, for instance, I deal with in my day job, but from the, how do we move the needle in how we conceptualize, you know, people like those who are food insecure, not because it's, you know, because of personal failings, but what, like what Steve was saying, and with his public health background, understanding that there are so many social determinants of health that make it so that being poor in America is the most expensive thing you could do, because it's just a vicious cycle once you get trapped in it. And of course, once it becomes the cycle of poverty, then it takes a whole matter and whole slew of measures to break it. And it's not like I have the answer one way or the other, but I just wish I saw more of the like bare minimum level of empathy to like get away from like the fundamental attribution of error of saying like, oh, it's that person's fault that they're hungry or that they're homeless, and just say like, let's just try a little bit. Let's just try at all to consider, you know, the more macro forces at work that may have, you know, caused things to be the way they are.
Yeah. Can I just jump in on that too, Jack, what you're saying and what everybody's been saying too, has been really like resonating with me in that, like, I'm seeing this in Alberta a lot more than I saw when I lived in Toronto or when I lived in BC. It's like this idea of personal responsibility, right? And like this myth of how personal, like if, like, even just with like COVID response here in Alberta, like government was basically saying, you know, oh, everyone just needs to be personally responsible, you know, and social distance on their own and like wear masks, you know, like they were so averse to this idea of being directive because, you know, they're libertarian maniacs to some extent. And like it, and, you know, and you could see this echoed also in our opioid response now with this government here. We used to have supervised consumption services and things like this, and they're shutting them down. Right. And the way, and they're like trying to apply 12-step sort of methodology to people who use drugs, and like having been in recovery and all that sort of stuff, it's like I can 12-step does not work most of the time for people who use opioids. If you are using opioids and if you fall out of 12-step instead of doing like the harm reduction, which works way, way better, you're dead, right? And it's like this idea, and you can see in like almost every single communication, the way that it just blankets and permeates. And the thing with Alberta that's really interesting too, is that it's pretty much like it's very much a conservative media environment as well. So that's something that I am still struggling with sometimes, because it's like, even here, our national broadcaster, CBC in Calgary, has like the most right-wing thing I've ever like posted and so on. And it's just like the way that this myth of personal responsibility that Jack was talking about, just, it seems to resonate in a way. And I don't know, other than like doing the slow work of, you know, and like, let's be real, like none of us, we're not having those longer conversations right now, right? Like the type of like issues-based canvassing, campaigning, and all that stuff that I could normally do, it's kind of out the window, right? So it's like trying to understand how to take the stuff that I know works and apply it in the COVID context has also been super frustrating from an organizing perspective. But yeah, like, I guess what I'm trying to get at is, if there is a way to break the back of this personal responsibility myth, and that, you know, and really driving home the point that, yes, in fact, we do live in society. What happens to my neighbor has an impact on me directly and indirectly. I think is a path forward to better, you know, relationships just on a local level with your neighbors, your community, and so on. But also, like, I just think that is the stuff that these reactionaries do not want us to do, right? Is to find common cause, which is why I love working people too, because it's like you're finding common cause with people that may not necessarily like track in the you know the most intersectional way or whatever. Like, I mean, sure, that's important, but it's also at the end of the day, like, I'm much happier talking to one of the roads workers that, you know, that I work with, that about like how this city councilor has screwed him and his coworkers over, than like kind of more academic stuff. And anyway, breaking the back of the myth of personal responsibility. That's the thing. If working people can figure that out and help us do that, that would be great. And give us the messaging to do it.
I think that point's important too. Has anybody seen any evidence through COVID that maybe that happened, that people were, I mean, it got clearly identified who the essential workers were. They weren't bank CEOs. They were, you know, people at the grocery store. And I don't know how far that's going, whether there's, I saw some, the needle moving some on that concern for other people, but I don't know. It doesn't seem like it's really been sustained at all.
I think it's been, that kind of initial, I think, sense of solidarity that, you know, we were witnessing maybe this time last year, right? Folks were on their balconies banging pots and pans, right? There was a lot of, a lot of genuine show of appreciation for essential workers. But then kind of our society did what it does best, which is squeeze us to the point where we almost have no choice but to just care about what is in front of us and what is like what we can keep in our own little circle, right? And how we can protect ourselves, because we sure as shit weren't getting a lot of the assistance that we needed from the government. And those, I guess that's where I would point to, is like those who did get extended unemployment benefits, those who were able to take a breather and actually kind of not just focus on the day-to-day grind, paying bills, paying rent, and so on and so forth, but actually have some time to think about life beyond that day-to-day grind. We're seeing kind of results of that psychological shift, and a lot of people saying, I'm not going back to work just for 7:25 for a fucking hour, right? You know, like, or I'm not there, or, you know, whether it's, you know, like the Frito-Lay worker that I talked to in Topeka, or the coal miners that Jacob talked to in Alabama, the Amazon workers, the gig workers that we talked to, there does seem to be, I think, something that we have confronted over the past year and a half, both in terms of our own mortality and in terms of the real bald cruelty of the society that we live in, that I think has instituted like some sort of important psychological shift in a fair number of workers who feel both that they deserve more than what the ruling class is offering. And also the thing that I've been like super fascinated by is just hearing more workers saying there's more to life than this, right? You know, there's more to working my every hour of the day and then coming home, going to sleep and missing every dinner with my family, missing every birthday, you know, that my parents have. It's actually my dad's birthday today. Shout out to Jesus. I'm going to call him after this call's done. But I don't know. I think that it took something like the pandemic to at least break the relentlessness of that day-to-day grind for a lot of people, for us to finally get that distance that we were talking about earlier, that I think Jules was mentioning, right? It's like even just a smidge of distance between the reality that we were always forced to accept and the possibility that it could be otherwise. Right. Even just seeing that, we see why the ruling class is so fucking adamant in keeping us from even seeing that sliver of daylight of another possible life. Right. I mean, Jack will remember that, you know, one of the texts that I taught a lot to students at Michigan was this speech by David Foster Wallace called This Is Water, where, you know, the anecdote that starts is that starts the speech is that there are two fish swimming in the sea. And they pass by an older fish, and this older fish says, "Morning, boys, how's the water?" And the two fish look at each other and they say, "What the hell is water?" Right? Because it's just such a taken for granted aspect of their reality that it's not even something that is up for questioning, not even something that you think is could be otherwise. And I think for a lot of folks going into the pandemic, that sort of grind of being always on the precarious edge of losing your home, right? Or of missing, you know, like crucial payments, of possibly losing custody of your kid, not being able to miss a shift because of all that, you know, it could do to fuck up your life, and thus taking more and more shit from your boss and your landlord and what have you, right? That's why they always wanted the you know, minimum wage to be what it was. That's why the ruling class always wants us to be in this kind of precarious position, because the moment we got some semblance of security, which now turns out to be like kind of the great anomaly in American history in the post-war boom years, that's when we were pushing for more, right? That's when like there was a more equitable, for a time, distribution of wealth and power. And then it all went away, right? The ruling class took it back. And now we're back to the same goddamn point. I know I'm going on a rant here, but like the point being is that I do think there is evidence to be hopeful that out of this horrifying past 2 years, folks have at least confronted both the existential need that we all have in us to live more and be more than what this capitalist hellscape allows us to be and allows us to do. But then also, yeah, this notion that we have it within our power, as Thomas Paine said, to make the world over again, right? That it could be otherwise. We saw the monster tremble, right? We saw the ruling class come out and say, go back to work, you lazy pieces of shit. Like, we're not raising the minimum wage. We're cutting off unemployment benefits. We are forcing you back into the meat grinder. There's nothing you're going to do about it. And people said, fuck off. They said, we quit. They left. And now, like, actually, the minimum wage in states around the country, I think, is closer to 15 across the board than it's ever been. Right. Like, that is a seismic shift in worker consciousness that I think is at least something to be hopeful about. But I know now I've talked over our end time. I don't know. Do folks, I don't want to take liberties with anyone's time, but I guess maybe going around the table, do folks want to share any final thoughts, either about what makes you hopeful or where you think we need to fight? Or if you have thoughts about where you want the show to go or things that you want us to do with the show, just love to hear from folks one more time before we wrap up.
Anyway. I haven't chimed in much. I'll just say it is what you just said is somewhat inspiring. At the same time, it feels like this was our chance. For me, the working class, it was our chance. You know, I've been working on something for the show, for our show, on the Spanish Civil War, specifically in Catalonia, and how the uprise in Catalonia was more of a socioeconomic revolution than a revolution against the Republicans versus the supporters of Franco. And had we been organizing around workers and working issues for far longer than we have, that, and maybe less politically organizing, we would have seen a more revolutionary spirit come to pass during this time than what we're seeing now. Because like you said, we've had a lot of workers that have said, fuck y'all, we're done. But they don't have any direction from that point forward. They know that they're sick of it, but they also don't know, what do we do? And the politicians and those reformists that support political change have no answers for them other than, let's continue to vote this way, or let's call your congressman and let's do this. And it seems to me like it's been such a losing battle, not just through the history of America, but through the history of politics in general. We may make some gains, but we'll lose in the end because money buys politics, and it always has, and it always will. The working class don't have money. The ruling class does. And it's disappointing because I feel like, you know, we're having to, it's almost like, okay, we've lost our chance this time, but let's keep organizing workers, not along political lines, but along socioeconomic lines. And, you know, one of the things I always go back to is one of the shows that I enjoy watching was Matawan in the mines in West Virginia. And one of the organizers, I can't remember the guy's name, the big heavyset black guy. He comes walking into town. He's looking for a job. And he comes straight to the union hall. And, you know, he gets called some of the typical names that you would think back then. And the organizer kind of stands up and says, look, boys, there's only two types of people in this world, those that work and those that don't. And he's a worker. And I think when we get into that mindset of we're all workers for the most part, except for the elitists that control this country. And we start talking about working issues and move away from political issues or the catchphrases that both sides love to use, then maybe we'll start making a lot more progress on what we want to see without actually having to say it when we start organizing around issues instead of organizing around politics. That's, you know, just my two cents.
This is why David is always so worth listening to. I think that's spot on, man. And just we'll have to have a longer conversation over some whiskey about that. But I guess I would say if folks want a deep cut, before I had an actual producer to make the show sound good, if you go back to season one, the big compilations that I did with GM workers, I think the episode called Solidarity, where I put together like a 15-minute reel of my favorite labor speeches, and that speech from Matawan is in there. And it gets me every time I need to get jacked up. I'll admit now in front of you guys that I go back and I listen to that reel, and that speech gives me fired the fuck up.